Magic Treehouse Book Number 33, Carnival at Candlelight by Mary Pope Osborne.
Chapter 7, The King and the Ruler. "Oh yeah, of course," whispered Jack. He had forgotten all about Teddy and Castle's book of magic rhymes. He pulled the book out of his backpack. He and Annie studied the table of contents. "Stand on water," said Annie. "Make a stone come alive. Make me soft. Turn to ducks. Flap through the ear. That's it." "No," said Jack. "Go back to make a stone come alive." "Why?" said Annie. "Because a lion's supposed to carry us," said Jack. "And he already has one. But he's made of stone. So all we need to make him come alive, right?" "All right," said Annie. "But then what?" said Jack. "Where will we go?" "Merlin Sanders said an angel of gold will show us the way. Remember?" said Annie. "Angel of gold?" said Jack. "Where were you going to find that? And how will we find Neptune? How will we help save Venice?" "Patience," said Annie. "If we need more magic, we'll go back to the book." "Okay, but let's hurry," said Jack. He opened Teddy and Catherine's book to the second rhyme. He took a deep breath, looked down at the line on the ledge. Then he read in a loud, clear voice. "Stone so sliding, cold and hard. Come, Matala, come, Mata Skahan." A crack inside seemed to came from deep within the lion's body. As Jack and Annie peered down the statue, a lion's stone mane ruffled into a mist of shaggy fur. His stone back softened into a sleek golden coat. His stone was stretched into long, luminous feathers. "Wow," breathed Annie. Jack can speak. Before their eyes, the statue had turned into a living nose with magnificent golden wings. The lion shook his mane and yawned. He had huge sharp teeth and long pink tongue. His ears twitched. His tuffy tail swung back and forth. The lion crouched and leapt off the toes like a cat. He spread his wings and caught a strong current of wings. His wings flapped, and then he began circling above the square. "Here, here!" Annie shouted. She waved wildly. The wing lagged to and flew back toward the tower. He glided sandy onto the toes, landed just a few feet away from Jack and Annie. He stared at them with his scorching eyes. "You have to help us save Venice from a flood disaster," Jack said. "Can you carry us to Neptune?" said Annie. The lion paddled toward them. He kept staring straight into them. He tilted his trembling head and let out a long growl, as if he was trying to answer. "We have to climb on your back," said Jack. "I hope it won't hurt you," said Annie. The lion let out another growl, but he didn't sound angry. He sounded as he was telling them to hurry. He crouched down so they can climb up. "I'll go first," Jack said to Annie. "I'll hold on to his mane, and you'll hold on to me." Jack slipped off his backpack and dropped it onto the terrace. "Take the book of rhymes," said Annie. "Got it," said Jack. He tucked the book under his arm and carefully climbed up the lion's back. Annie climbed on behind Jack and wrapped her arm tightly around his waist. Jack twisted his fingers around to the lion's mane. The mane felt strangely soft. "Okay, we're ready," said Jack. The lion stood up. He trembled slightly, then he leapt off the terrace. "Ah!" Jack yelled. The lion book slipped from under his arm and fell down into a flooded square below. "Oh no, our book!" cried Jack. "Hang on!" cried Annie. The lion flapped his great wings and roared through the sky. Jack pressed his knees onto the lion's warm back and clung to his mane. The lion flew towards the fireworks. A shower of red sparks were opening like an umbrella. Booms and whistles were filled the night. Fairy bits ran down through the darkness, once more into the canal. "Help! We're headed straight into the fireworks!" cried Annie. The lion dipped and turned away from the fireworks. The red shower gave way to bursts of blue and green. "Which way do we go?" shouted Annie. As the lion flew back towards the square, Jack saw a gold weather wing on top of the watchdog. It was in the shape of an angel. "The angel of gold!" shouted Jack. The weather wing was no longer pointing north with the wind. The angel turned directly around, pointing in all directions. "Fly closer to the angel!" shouted Annie. The lion turned and flew to the watchtower. As it drew nearer towards the golden angel, Jack called out, "Which way do we go? Which way?" The weather vane turned a full circle and came to a complete stop. The engine was pointing towards the southeast over the tapping waves to the sea, and it caught over the wind. The lion turned and soared into the wind, his strong wings shining the gold. "Oh, wow," said Annie. The flying lion guided past fireworks and over the wide canal, leaving Minnie's behind them. He flew high over the stormy seas. Jack gripped the lion's mane with all his might. The lion still in and out of thick, fastened clouds. It flew about, crashing waves and bolts of lightning. It flew through screaming waves and pedaling rain. In the middle of the sea, far from them, the lion began circling above the water. "What's he doing?" cried Jack. "Looking for Neptune," shouted Annie. "But Neptune's not real," said Jack. "I know," shouted Annie. "You have to use our imaginations. Like Lord Zeno, try to imagine Neptune." Jack tried to imagine Neptune, but he was too scared to think clearly. "Neptune!" shouted Annie. "We're out from the water. Stay beneath. Neptune, help us!" Annie's voice was lost in the wind. Jack wrapped his arms around the lion's neck. He brought his face to the lion's mane. He tried to desperately imagine Neptune. The lion let out a roar. With his hand under the lion's throat, Jack felt that he was self-roaring. The lion roared again. The roar made Jack feel stronger and calmer. The detail of deep blue space became his mind. In his imagination, Jack saw Neptune, ruler of the seas, with his white beard and long hair, his jaw on the shoulders. It's a lovely lady who was beneath, the grand lady of the lagoon. He saw Neptune giving the grand lady a gift. "I see something!" cried Annie. Jack opened his eyes and sat up. "Where?" he cried. "In the water," said Annie. Clinging to the lion's mane, Jack peered down into the darkness below. Lightning flashed over to the sea. Jack saw a huge three-pronged spear rising out of foaming, churning waves. The sea below, the spear began to heave and blow. Lightning flashed again, and Jack saw a great mass of swirling seaweed rising from the waves. "Not seaweed here," Jack realized. A man was standing here and neck appeared above the surface of the water. Then the man's massive shoulders, chest, and arms rolled through the storm-tossed sea. The giant loomed high above them, as tall as a mountain. "Neptune!" cried Annie. The lion let out a roar and another. Lit by flashes of lightning, Neptune's face looked as if it had been weathered by thousands of years of wind and sand and waves. He had deep-set eyes, cloudy cheeks, a white beard, a tangled hair hanging to his shoulders. "Neptune, save Venice from the flood!" cried Jack. "Please," cried Annie, "save the grand lady of the lagoon!" Neptune looked at them for a moment. Then, with his powerful arm, he lifted his spear and thrust it down into the waves. When the spear approached the surface of the water, the sea made a gurgling sound, and then a long slurp, as if water were flowing down a drain. The thunder and lightning stopped. The storm-tossed waves grew calm. The wind led to a gentle breeze. The clouds parted, and the stars shone brightly. Neptune reached the spear. He nodded to Jack and Annie and the lion. "Thanks," cried Annie. "Thanks," shouted Jack. The lion roared again. The Neptune began to sink back into the sea. His long arms, huge shoulders, thick neck, craggy face, floating hair all disappeared. The prongs of his spear sank below the surface of the water. The ruler of the seas were gone. Only a shimmering whirlpool swirled in the moonlight.